Good morning. Glad you're here. I tell you, there is no place like home. When you have sat at an airport for 2 days, we're glad to be home. Next Sunday morning, in both services, Pastor Barry and I are going to talk about our trip to Peru. As a matter of fact, in the bulletin today, there is a list of missionary expenses that come out of the money you give toward mission causes. You'll see there's some money designated there for the trip to Peru. We bought textbooks for the students at the seminary. I had 27 students that I taught, and we supplied some other needs. And so everything you see there in that list are for needs that have been taken care of, not necessarily buy somebody a ticket to go somewhere. That's not it, but it's to help cover the needs that are there in those ministries. And that's what you've done. I will tell you, without spending a whole lot of time talking about this today, because we're going to talk about it next week, we had some divine moments of ministry while we were there in Peru. No matter how much it costs to go, you can't put a price on somebody coming to know the Lord, can you? And when we went to Cerritos Village, where there's not a gospel witness, not a gospel witness, not a gospel witness. You understand what I'm saying? We came across a lady that we shared toys with that Mr. Bob had made with children. The mother came outside, and the gospel was shared with this lady. And there on the spot, she trusted Jesus Christ as her Lord and Savior. I will tell you, that makes the trip worthwhile. But she has said, I will open my home for the purpose of a church being planted here if we can find a pastor and somebody will come here and preach the gospel. I will tell you, church, there is no substitute for that. And we had occasion, over and over again, where saw God show himself mighty in what we were doing. So you want to come next week, because we got video, we have pictures, we have testimonies. And I think it's a possibility that the vice president of GRASP International, Skip Farron, will be with us next Sunday morning to come. He said, I don't want to say anything, but we may let him say something. But he will be with us. But it was an awesome week. God shook a nation. God shook villages. God made himself known. People were saved. It was a wonderful thing. So thank you so much for your prayers and support and encouragement in that trip. Thank you, Brian, for preaching last week. Heard one of the wonderful things about you sharing with our group. Today we are in the second message in a series on the Word of God speak. 2 weeks ago when we spoke, it was Word of God speak, may I treasure the Word of God in my heart. Today it's Word of God speak, and it's open my eyes. Open my eyes. The text is found in Psalm 119, beginning with the 17th verse and reading through the 24th verse. And then there's a focal passage. And when I say the focal passage would be verse 18 that we want to hone in on and focus on and the message today. This is the word of the Lord, Psalm 119, verses 17 through 24. Deal bountifully with your servant, that I may live and keep your word. Open my eyes that I may behold wonderful things from your law. I am a stranger in the earth. Do not hide your commandments from me. My soul is crushed with longing after your ordinances at all times. You rebuke the arrogant, the cursed who wander from your commandments. Take away reproach and contempt from me, for I observe your testimonies. Even though princes sit and talk against me, your servant meditates on your statutes. Your testimonies are my delight. They are many counselors. Would you pray with me, please? Our Father in heaven, today we thank you for the privilege to gather in this place and worship you in spirit and in truth. Your word is truth, and your word will not return void, but it will go forth and accomplish every purpose for which it has been ordained to accomplish. Today, Father, I am the mouthpiece, but I am not the teacher. The Holy Spirit, who dwells within us, is the teacher. And so we say to you, Holy Spirit, our teacher, help us to glean and grasp and understand and make application of the word we hear today, that we might grow in grace and the knowledge of the Lord, but also that we might come to know in a deeper way the mind of God, the mind of Christ. Lord, help us to desire you as a deer pants and thirsts for the water. Help us, Lord, to thirst for you. I pray you would station your angels around this place. Cover us in the blood of the Lord Jesus. Speak to our hearts. Encourage us. If there's someone here today that doesn't know Jesus, lift the veil from their eyes so they see their lostness and their need of a Savior. But Lord, today we want to sit at your feet and we want to be taught and want to grow and we want to learn. So help us to do that, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. The 18th verse is the focal passage. We're going to hone in on that. It says, open my eyes that I may behold the wonderful things from your law. Open my eyes that I may behold, that I may look upon, that I may gaze upon, that I may meditate upon, that I might feast upon, that I might get underneath and understand your law. This verse and these other verses are a combination of a prayer and the Word of God. And this is a prayer that we should be praying every day. We should pray every day that God would enable us to understand His Word and His truth, and that the Holy Spirit, our teacher, would teach us the truth of His Word, and that He would enable us to make application of the Word. Now listen, to just read the Bible and check off a box that I did my devotion today is not sufficient. Now, we may feel good about ourselves. Well, I read my scripture today. I did my little private time, my quiet moment. It took 3 minutes. I check off my box. I read the scripture. And I don't minimize that. That's better than nothing. But that's not really how you come to understand the deeper things of God and to know the mind of Christ and to know the mind of God. And for you and I, as followers of Jesus Christ, the ultimate desire of our heart would be to know Christ and the power of His resurrection, as the Apostle Paul prayed. And to have a hunger and a desire for His Word and thirst for it and crave it and feast upon it and meditate upon it. To love it. When we were getting some stuff out of Deborah's mom's house after she passed away, Deborah came across a box. And I could tell the box was very dear to her. And I said, what's in the box? She said, in this box are all the love letters you've written to me. I said, oh my gosh. I said, you kept them? Sure, I kept them. They're right here in this box. Love letters. And I could hear Engelbert Humperdinck's love letters stray from your heart. Keep us so near while apart, you know. And I could see the sincerity and the passion. Those were love letters that I wrote her. And she cherished them. I want to tell you something. This right here, know what it is? It's a love letter. It's a love letter that was delivered to you and me through the author himself, God the Father, Jesus Christ the Son. And you and I should desire Him, and our desire should be that God would open our heart and our eyes to see truth. So we should pray every day, God, help me to come to understand, to know your word and your truth. Now, in the bulletin, there's some boxes that you can take notes and put some stuff in if you'd like. That's up to you. One of the boxes says this in the box, there are many wonderful things in the Word of God. And if you want to jot anything in the box, you can. Leave that up to you. Here's what the psalmist is saying. There are many, many, many wonderful things in the Word of God. And there are many wonderful things in the Word of God. And we want to understand the wonderful things from God and from God's law. Now, you will recall the first message in 119, we talked about the 9 different references to the Word of God. It can be statutes, it can be precepts, it can be law. Well, the word here is law. It is a Torah, it means instruction, it means teaching. He says, open my eyes and I may behold the wonderful things from your law, from your teaching, from your instruction. And God has many wonderful teachings and instructions for us in the Scriptures. And the teaching and instruction that God has for us is so wonderful. And when we are able to understand it and make application of it to our lives, it changes our lives profoundly. Can I tell you, I'm not the same person I was years ago. I am a new creation in Christ Jesus. And my life is changing daily as I meditate upon the Word and I take on the very virtues of Jesus Christ. I mean, that's what we're to be. We're to take on the virtues of Jesus Christ, and every day of our lives we're to look more and more and more like Him. And my family, my dad's sister tells me all the time, you look more and more like your daddy every day. The older you get and the whiter your hair gets. Now, I don't want to hear that, but anyway. And it's the DNA. And as we grow in grace and the knowledge of our Lord and we hide His Word in our heart, we begin to like Him. And the Word of God profoundly changes us. And the Word of God, when we understand it, see it, grasp it, can comprehend it, it will empower us with a life of holiness. Holiness. Say holiness. Holiness. Don't be scared of that word. Oh, holiness, they run around and shout and scream. Holiness, I'm not talking about some particular demeanor of worship. I'm talking about a holiness, a reverence, an awe, a reflection of their character and the virtues and the nature of who God is. I will tell you, if this world, if America, if North America is ever to come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, it will be because finally, once and for all, they have seen in the church the holiness of God. The holiness of God. It's missing, it's lacking. We look more like them than we look like Him, to the shame of the gospel. When we get in the Word of God and the Word of God begins to transform us, we are changed profoundly, and we take on an aroma and a fragrance of holiness, and we are infused with the love of God. Now, I want to think more highly of myself than I ought, nor do you. But some of us are kind of hard to love. Now, I admit, there's a lot to love here if you look at me. But some of us are hard to love. And it's especially hard to love people whose ways are different than our ways and thoughts are different than our thoughts. And it's really hard to love those people outside the wall of the church that do not understand why we feel so passionate about the life of the unborn. And why we feel so passionate about what marriage is. And they don't understand because they have no spiritual discernment to understand the truth and the reality of God's Word. But we have to love them. The Bible says so. Now, most of the time, we want to slap them upside the head. But God says, love them. How can you love them? God has to do that. And we hide the Word of God in our heart. We become like Christ and we take on the mind of Christ and we know the mind of Christ. We are infused with the wonderful love of God, and there's cultivated within our heart a desire for the Scripture, a desire for the Word, a desire to know Christ. And we need to know God's Word by memory. You can do that. And we need to know God's Word by application. James says, do not be simply a hearer of the Word, but be a doer of the Word. So listen. You've come to the house of God today. You're at Bethany Baptist Church or whatever church you are today, because there'll be people listening this later. And you've heard the Word of God. Now, I will tell you, there's a misconception about that some people have about this thing of spirituality and walking with God, being religious. And they think, here's what they think. I went to church, I heard the Word of God, and that's all God expects of me. Wrong, wrong, wrong. Wrong. I think I'll say it one more time. Wrong. It is, I went to church, I heard the Word of God, and I will make application of the Word of God which I heard, and I will obey. Here's what the Scripture says. Do not be content just to hear the Word, but be doers of the Word of God. Now, if you come in here today and hear everything that's said, and you walk out those doors, and there is no application of the Word that you've heard today, what have you gained by being here? What really have you gained by being here? Well, you know, I look good to God. Really? We have to make application of the Word of God. And we have to have a desire for the Word of God and want to know it. Let me tell you, I don't want to get on this tangent because I'll talk about it and time will be up. But it was my privilege to go to Peru. Thank you for letting me go. Thank you for praying for me. Thank you for helping through your mission funds to provide textbooks for the seminary students. I had 27 seminary students in the Peruvian International Seminary that I taught the book of Philippians. Now, I will tell you that I've been in Moldova and I preached the gospel and I saw them hungry for the gospel and I saw people come to Jesus Christ by the droves, by the hundreds. But I went to teach this seminary class in the book of Philippians at the Peruvian International Seminary, and I saw people that literally were like human sponges that were soaking up the Word of God, and they were taking notes so fast, and every word I said, they were taking it so fast, it almost looked like there were steam coming from their pens. They were writing so fast and hard. And the barrier was I'm speaking English, the translator is speaking Spanish, and the Holy Spirit's involved in giving illumination of what's being said, and they were soaking up the Word of God. And I thought to myself, oh God, if that were the case in our churches in America, what could you not do to turn our nation upside down? We're so nominal in our desire to know Him better. And we need to know Him better. And we need to desire Him. There are many wonderful things in the Word of God. Second box, you'll see this. No one can understand the Word of God without God's help. You need to know that. You and I cannot understand and comprehend and make application of the Word of God without God's help. If God doesn't open our eyes, we will not be able to see the wonderful truth of His Word. We can only understand the beauty of His Word and the text by the illuminating power of the Holy Spirit. Now, I mentioned in my prayer that I am up here and I'm the vessel through which God speaks, and I'm using my voice and my voice box, and I've studied and I've prepared and I've written notes and those kind of things. But I'm not the teacher. Are y'all with me? I'm not the teacher. The teacher is the Holy Spirit. The teacher is the Holy Spirit that is within you as a child of God that gives you illumination to see, to comprehend, to understand the Word that's being preached or taught. And in your quiet time, it is the Holy Spirit that gives you illumination, that puts the light on the text, enables you to see and understand and make application. How many of you here have ever had cataracts? Come on, be honest. I know we think cataracts. I ain't raising my hand. If you got cataracts, you've been old. I've got cataracts, and I beg your pardon, I am not old. Listen to me. Had cataracts on both eyes. But you know what I noticed about cataracts? I needed so much light to be able to see. I'd try to read my Bible, and I couldn't see. And I'd get a light right over my head trying to see. The cataracts prevented me having the light I needed to see. But when the cataracts were removed, I had more light. The Holy Spirit is the light that comes on. And you know, some preachers get a little frustrated. They teach and teach and teach. And you have some guy to come in and teach. And they teach the same thing you taught 2 weeks ago. And a lady says, Pastor, I got it, I got it, I got it. And you say, I said the same thing 2 weeks ago. You know what happened? The light came on. Didn't necessarily have anything to do with the vocal instrument. It had everything to do with the power of the Holy Spirit that turned on the light that enabled him to see. We need the Holy Spirit to teach us. And I will tell you, a person that cannot have and does not have the illuminating power of the Holy Spirit when they read the Word of God, you know what it's like? It's like a blind man that feels the sun on his face. Now, he can feel the sun, and he feels the warmth of the sun, and he enjoys the warmth of the sun, but because he is blind, He cannot see the glory of it. He cannot see the beauty of it. He cannot see the majestic moment of the sun. He can only feel it. A person who has the illuminating power of the Holy Spirit, when they study the Word of God, can see the glory of the Word of God, the wonder of the Word of God, the majestic beauty of God's Word, and they can relish it, and their lives can be transformed. And the truly deeper things of God require the illumination of the Holy Spirit to comprehend. And it's possible you can read your Bible and not get the depth and the truth of the reality of the deeper things of God. Why? Because you're lacking in spiritual discernment. Let me tell you something. Reading the Bible is not like reading Edgar Allan Poe. Reading the Bible is not like reading your favorite novel. The Bible is a spiritual book with spiritual truth written by God, which requires the work of the Holy Spirit and the illuminating power of the Holy Spirit for you to understand and comprehend. In Ephesians 4:18, it says this, being darkened in their understanding, excluded from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them, because of the hardness of their hearts. In other words, he says, they can't comprehend the truth of God's word because they're darkened, their hearts are darkened, and they're excluded from the life of God, and there's an ignorance due to the hardness of their hearts. When people can't comprehend, there's an indication that there's a problem. A problem. Now, who were the most religious appearing people that were on the earth in Jesus' day? Who was it? Pharisees. Pharisees were religious. They crossed every T, they dotted every I. The Pharisees were very religious. They thought of themselves to be experts in the scriptures. Now, did you hear what I said? The Pharisees thought of themselves to be experts in the scriptures. They knew the scriptures, but you know what? They did not know the God of the scriptures. But they thought they knew the scriptures. Do you know what Jesus said about them? These religious people who went to church every week, like some of us. Here's what he said. Seeing, they do not see. Huh? Seeing, they do not see. Hearing, they do not hear. Is that you? I mean, he said this about religious people who thought they knew the scriptures. Seeing, they don't see. And hearing, they don't hear. You see, we can deceive ourselves into thinking that we can understand the Word of God and the deeper truths of God, but this discernment is not coming from the flesh or human wisdom. But rather, we are dependent upon the illuminating power of the Holy Spirit to comprehend and be enlightened by the Word, by the fire of God and the light of God. We must be illuminated and enlightened by the Word of God through the Holy Spirit. God wants you to see this. God wants you to get this. God doesn't want to make this difficult and hard. And the first thing I would say to you is get you a Bible you can read and comprehend. I read out of the New American Standard. I read out of the Christian Standard, Holman Christian Standard. Matter of fact, Lifeway is coming out in March with the Christian Standard Bible. They're dropping the H off Holman Christian Standard, and they're changing a few words. They're not changing the text and the meaning. But you need to get your Bible you can read and understand that is close to the original text. New American Standard is close to the original text. Holman Christian Standard is close to the original text. And as you open that Bible, you need to pray when you open the Scripture that God would give you comprehension and understand. But you can't understand it on your own and in your flesh and with human reason. You might understand what a word is, what a thee or a thou or a verb or an adjective and all those things. But do you really understand what God's saying in the context that's being written? You need the power of the Holy Spirit. And here's what you and I need to understand along these lines of spiritual discernment. There are three kinds of people in this world. Everybody in here, you're one of the three. Everybody in here, one of the three. There's a natural man or the natural woman. Paul writes about this in 1 Corinthians. The natural man or the natural woman are those people who have no spiritual discernment whatsoever. They cannot tell you what the Word of God says. They cannot comprehend the Word of God. They think the Word of God is foolishness. They think the preaching of the cross is foolishness. They think we're foolish. And that would be the people outside the walls of this church that don't get it, why we're pro-life. Don't get it because we believe marriage ought to be what God says it ought to be in the Bible. They have no spiritual discernment whatsoever because they do not know Jesus Christ and have the power of the Holy Spirit within them where they can comprehend and understand. Now, I'm preaching to an older group in this service, so you will know what I'm talking about. Many, many years ago, when I was a boy, a teenager, there was an evangelist named Bob Harrington, the chaplain of Bourbon Street, who engaged in debate with Madeline Murr O'Hara, who was a professed atheist who did not believe in God and was one of the means of taking prayer out of the school. And Bob Harrington would debate the Bible with her and debate the Scripture with her to no avail. She had no spiritual discernment whatsoever. They were butting their heads together worse than two billy goats. Now, I'm not saying that we should not engage in exciting conversation with those who don't understand the Scripture, but I want to tell you something. I cannot convince somebody to trust God. And by the way, on those occasions, and I don't know if it's ever happened, it may have, Al Oquin converts don't last very long. Not that I've had any. I can't convince anybody to trust God and to know God. That is a work of the power of the Holy Spirit. It is a supernatural work done by the Spirit of God who convicts the heart and lifts the veil from man's eyes that he sees his lostness, and he turns from sin and self and he trusts the Savior. So when we're debating with folks outside who don't know God, they're the natural people who don't understand spiritual things. You got to love them, but they can never comprehend what you're saying. They have no spiritual discernment. The second kind of person in the Scripture that Paul talks about are the carnal man and woman, and there are people who are believers. They're Christian. Paul calls them saints in 1 Corinthians. They're saints. They're not perfect. They're saints. They've trusted Christ, but he says they're carnal. They're carnal. They're carnal. They're not living spiritual directed lives. They're living their lives more according to the dictates of their heart and the passions of the flesh than they are the desires of the Spirit and desiring the Word of God. And they're not growing spiritually. Paul said to them, I would love to feed you the steak of the Word of God, but I can't do that because you're still on baby food. You need to understand the mind of Christ. You need to understand the deeper things of God. I want to teach you the deeper things of God, but you're still on baby food. And you've been eating baby food for years and years and years and years. Let me tell you an example. And I don't want to chase a rabbit here. I'm getting off track. But anyway, here I go. When you have a testimony service, man, I like this big stage. I can walk all the way over here. When you have a testimony service and you say, somebody stand up and tell us what God's doing for you. Now, I'm not minimizing this and I'm not poking fun, but I'm just trying to give an example. And you stand up and your testimony of what God's doing for you is that he saved you 60 years ago. If that is the freshness of your testimony, oh, God have mercy. If that is the freshness of your testimony, you need to repent and get right with God. I got saved when I was 9, but I've had some experience with my salvation. Blew the doors off. Salvation is a constant turning. And if the freshest word you can give about what God is doing for you is when he saved you 60 years ago, you're not very much aware of what God's doing in your life today and yesterday and days past. God help us, God help us, God help us. You know what that's a demonstration of? Carnality. Still on baby food. The freshest testimony you got is God saved me when I was 10 years old and now you're 60 or you're 70 or you're 50 or you're 40.
Then there's a spiritual man who has the Spirit of God and desires the Spirit of God and desires to understand the Word of God. And his yearning is to know God and know the mind of Christ and to walk in oneness with the Lord and know the Lord in the power of his resurrection. That's a spiritual-minded person. And we cannot see the glory and wonder of the Scripture without God opening our heart and minds and giving us spiritual sense of understanding. Let me tell you something. There is a correlation. Don't miss this. There is a correlation between the individual that's living a carnally directed life and the shallowness of their spirituality. And there is a correlation between the one that's living a spiritual directed life and the growth and the magnitude of coming like Christ daily. Where are we? God wants us to know him. Fourth box, whichever one it is. We need to pray for God to help us to see and hear his word. Now, do you want to know God? Do you want to know God better? Do you want to know God's word? Do you want to have the mind of Christ? Do you desire the mind of Christ? Then we need to pray God to help us. And if we're going to stay pure and clean and moral, we have to hide the word of God in our heart, and we must be desperate for God, and we must pray the word of God that God would open the eyes of our heart and the eyes of our inner being to see truth and know truth. And when we see the truth, listen, when we see the truth and we make application of the truth of the Word of God, our lives will be changed. A man or a woman that tells me they've come to Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior and their life hasn't changed, they haven't come to Jesus Christ. I beg your pardon. And when you spend time in the Word of God every day, every day, every day, every day, every day, every day, meditating, chewing, making application, your life will change. Open your Bible to Ephesians chapter 1. I'm talking fast. You said you were already talking fast, preacher. I'm going to talk faster. Come on. Ephesians chapter 1. Time's moving on. Ephesians chapter 1. Verses 15 through 21, and this is the prayer that Paul prayed for the church at Ephesus because he wanted them to grow in grace and the knowledge of the Lord, and he understood God must help us grow spiritually. God must give us illumination and understanding through the Holy Spirit to understand his word. Ephesians 1, 15 through 21. For this reason I too, having heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, would exist among you, and your love for all the saints, do not cease giving thanks for you while making mention of you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of all glory, may give to you a spirit of wisdom. What does he pray? God, give them a spirit of wisdom. So when you open the Bible, God, give me a spirit of wisdom. And he prays, not only a spirit of wisdom, but God, give them revelation in the knowledge of you. God, open their mind, open their heart, give them spiritual wisdom, give them revelation. Let them see you as you are in the light of the Scriptures. Give them revelation. And then notice what he says. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling and what are the riches of his glory, of his inheritance in the saint, and what is the surpassing greatness of his power toward us who believe. These are in accordance with the working of the strength of his might. That's as far as I'll read. Here's what he's saying. If you're reading one translation, it says this. I'm praying that you might be strengthened in your inner man, that the eyes of your inner man might be open and enlightened to the reality of Jesus Christ and who he is. You don't get this by human reasoning. You get it through the unction and the illumination of the Holy Spirit, and the eyes of our inner man must be enlightened and made aware of the true riches of Christ. Now, why do we pray that, and why do we need spiritual illumination? Because the Word of God is crucial to a life of holiness. John 17:17 says we're sanctified by the Word of God. And if you and I are going to be a work of sanctification, and we are to be growing in grace in our Lord, and the work of sanctification has been going on in our heart and life daily, it will be because of the Word of God. We need to understand that we cannot see God without his help, and we must pray for God to help us see. Now, in that last box, in the bulletin, when it says we need to pray for God to help us to see and hear, I want to list seven things, and I'm going to give them to you quickly. And I thank God for the commentaries and the preachers and all that I've read, that, you know, all this stuff that have given me insight. And I'm using some of their stuff, and I'm using what God had said to me. There's nothing original, you know. Seven kinds of prayers when you're reading the Bible. And you jot these down, and then we're going to pray and we're going to go. But I want you to understand that when you open the Bible, if you're going to get it, the Holy Spirit has to help you get it. You're not going to get it on your own. You're not going to get it in human reasoning. Here it is, first one. God, teach us your word. That's what we need to pray. God, teach us your word. Psalm 119, 12, that's what the psalmist said. Teach me your statutes, O Lord. So when I open my Bible to have my devotion in the morning, I'm praying, God, teach me your word. The Holy Spirit is my teacher. Teach me. The second thing I pray is, God, don't hide your word from me. God, don't hide your word from us. Don't hide your word from us, God. Psalm 119, 19, the psalmist said, do not hide your commandments from me. I don't think that it's God that hides his word from us, but I do think this. I think when we've compromised the wholeness of God, and we don't have an infusion of the fullness of the Holy Spirit where we depend upon him and listen to him, that we can miss it. Kind of like having cataracts. You don't have enough light to see. And when there's unconfessed sin in your heart and life, it hinders you understanding, comprehending, and seeing the Word of God. So it's as much as on us as it is anything. God, don't hide your Word from us. Help me to see. Help me to see. Number three. God, make me understand your word. Now that is a strong, powerful word there. When it says, God, make. You understand what I'm saying? Make. My dad pulled out his belt one time and said, I'm going to make you do this. Now there wasn't much pushback for me when he pulled out his belt and he said, I'm going to make you do this. Because he was the authority. He was the one driving it, and he had a belt in his hand. When we say, God, make us understand your word, here's what the psalmist said in Psalm 119, 27. Make me understand the way of your precepts. Make me. Now, I want to tell you something. God knows how to make us do things. Would you agree with me that God has ways of getting our attention that we could never begin to imagine? You know that? Many, many years ago, I was dealing with a bull-headed, hard-headed man in a church I served way back yonder, many years ago, who wouldn't listen, who was belligerent, who was ornery, who was argumentative, he was always pushing back, giving me a hard time all the time against this and against that and against this and against that. And he had no desire for the Word of God. But you know what? God put him flat on his back in a hospital room under an oxygen tent. And he's sucking wind trying to breathe, and he thought he might die. Now, I want to tell you something. When you're about to meet God, does that get your attention? God has ways of making us pay attention. Miss Sarah Jones in sixth grade said, come up here, Aloe Quinn. Now, they can't do this today. But she was going to make me pay attention. She took my palm and bent it back, and she took a ruler and swapped me right on the middle of the hand. And I told my daddy, and he didn't say, I'm going to go over there and give that woman a piece of my mind. He said, I ought to pull my belt and whip your butt right now. I'm telling you. He supported the teacher. He wasn't against her. God has a way to make us get it, or at least put us in a position where we can. Fourthly, give us a hunger and desire for your word. Psalm 119, 36. Incline my heart to your testimonies and not to dishonest gain. Now get this. Don't miss it. God, give me a hunger and desire for your word. You see what the psalmist is saying in Psalm 119, 36? Incline my heart to your testimonies and not to dishonest gain. But I want to stretch that a little bit. What's the desire of your heart? You want to make it big in the stock market. You want wealth, fortune, fame, prosperity, house okay, car okay, wife okay, kids okay. We have desires to live comfortable lives. And we desire the comfort, and we desire the riches, and we desire the wealth. And the psalmist is saying here, God, incline my heart to your testimonies more so to anything that I could gain in this life, and especially dishonest gain. That says a whole lot about us, church, I'm telling you. about the desire of our heart and what we desire. Lord, I want to incline my heart to your testimonies. Give me a hunger. And I stood in the front of that Peruvian International Seminary, and I watched those 27 students hang on every word I said, and write and write and write and write. And after every chapter, we'd stop, and I'd ask questions, and I'd answer those questions to a translator, and I have to stop. We can't have any more questions. We've got to go to the second chapter. We have to get through this in 20 hours. Sponges. Desiring the Word, desiring the Word, desiring the Word, desiring the Word, desiring the Word. They shame us, I'll tell you that. They want to know God. God, give us a hunger and desire. Fifthly, help me keep your word. God, help me keep your word. Help me keep your word. Psalm 119:88, revive me according to the loving kindness so that I might keep the testimony of your mouth. God, help me to keep your word. Now, I'm going to tell you something. Here's what happens every Sunday morning. You come to church, you sit, you hear a sermon, you hear a message, you worship, and I want to tell you, before the week is over, you've lost the word that you heard. You've not kept it. What, preacher? You losing your mind? No, I'm not losing my mind. Listen to me. Do you know what would steal the word of God out of your heart? Your cares, your troubles, your worries, your anxieties, your fears, your frustrations, your hardships. Steals the word. When Jesus taught the parable of the sower, he said some falls on the hard ground. It doesn't take root. Some falls on the thorny ground and it looks like it's going to make it, but the weeds grow up and choke it out. Some falls on the ground that's fertile. It goes down, it takes root, it comes up. Let me tell you, the Word of God has to stay in our heart, and we have to pray, God, help me to keep the Word. And the enemy, listen, Bethany, the enemy, Satan himself, does not want you to keep the Word you've heard today. He wants anything and everything to steal it away, take it away. And you get out of here and you start worrying and stressed and angry and upset and full of trials and full of tribulations and full of hardships. The last thing on your mind is what you heard today. The cares of this world takes away the word you've heard. So we need to pray. God, help me keep the word. I'm almost done. Stay with me. Number six, establish my steps in your word. God, help me as I read the word and you give me understanding and I meditate upon it. Help me, Lord, to establish my steps in your word. Psalm 119, verse 133. Establish my footsteps in your word. Here's what it means. Lord, let your word perform in me. God, when I read the Word of God and I study it and I meditate upon it and the Holy Spirit gives me illumination and I begin to understand the deeper things of God, God, let your Word perform in me. Let it perform in me. And somebody says, "You, man, what's going on with you? Man, you look different. Wow. Did you get a facelift?" No, I ain't get a facelift. Wow, your face just glows. It's radiant. Your face is lit. Oh, you're lying to me. You had a facelift. No, I did not have a facelift. Well, what's your explanation? I just got more Jesus. I make an application of his word. You know all that worried and stressed kind of stuff you saw on my face? You don't see it anymore. Because I want God's word to perform in my life. Last one. God, seek me when I go astray from your word. You want another psalm? Psalm 119, 176. I have gone astray like a lost sheep, like a lost sheep. Seek your servant. And I will tell you, church, that God wants us to know him. And God wants us to know him in the power of the resurrection. But we have to be willing to discipline our lives to spend time in his word. And we have to pray, God, illuminate us and give us understanding of the scripture if we're to know it. And I know you may have graduated from tech, and bless your heart, but you ain't got enough smarts to figure out the word of God on your own. And those who went to Georgia don't got a prayer. Listen. And I'm a Georgia fan. The thing I'm saying today is this. You can't know the things of God except God lifted the veil up. And He did that in our conversion. And now we have the Holy Spirit in us to give us illumination. But you can't rush through this thing of knowing God. Hear me. You can't rush through this thing. The Lord wants us to sit at His feet. It's hard to do in America. Everybody's going 100 miles an hour in 1,000 directions, and we got so many hobbies and so many activities and so many things that distract us, so many things that call for our time, and so many things that need our energy, so many things that need our focus. And so what we got? God gets leftover stuff. Leftover time, leftover attention. But if you really want to know Him, He becomes the priority, and that's what we're trying to talk about this year. And we make sure that we designate the time we need in a priority fashion to sit at His feet and say, Holy Spirit, teach me to know the deeper things of God. And we pray, open my eyes, Lord. I want to see Jesus, to reach out and touch Him. Tell Him I love Him. Open my eyes, Lord, our ears, and help me to listen. Right? Open my eyes, Lord. Why? I want to see Jesus. I don't want to come to church and see the preacher. And I don't want to come to church and see the deacon. And I don't want to come to church and see the choir and all you beautiful people. I want to come. You know who I want to see? Jesus. Let's pray. Father, work to the degree of Your will now. Convict our hearts about our nominal desire for You and Your Word. Help us to make it a priority. And help us to recognize, regardless of how intelligent and bright we are, we need Your help to understand and comprehend and apply Your Word. If there's someone here today that needs Jesus, lift the veil from their eyes. Help them to see. We pray it in Jesus' name. We stand as we sing.